Wrestling talk. You know, that's all we talk about, I know. But, yeah. But, there it is. Yeah. So, we're gonna start off with Impact, because we just watched it. Well, I just watched it. It came in when I was in the middle.
Yeah.
So, yeah, no, it was a good show. The main event lived up to what I imagined.
Here's the thing. Because Barbed Wire Massacre is such a, for lack of a better term, violent, vicious match, it was pulled from TV. Now, Impact Wrestling knew that people would want to watch it, so they put it on this Twitch channel, whatever it is. And if you have that, if you're able to find whatever, you could watch it. But, for us, it was more or less, look it up on YouTube.
Yeah, but, you know, that was a good show, like I said. It was Congo Kong versus...
Yeah, Congo Kong against Chandler Park, cousin of Joseph Park.
Yeah, and, you know, kind of looking back, I was telling Kyle... I was watching many years ago Legend City Wrestling, which was in the Maritimes, Newfoundland, Labrador. But seeing Congo Kong, he looks a lot better now than he did back then. I mean, now he's got the tribal makeup and whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, this match, I think you obviously knew that it was going to go to one person.
The biggest thing about this show. Was okay, you had the match with Congo Kong and Chandler Park. It showed the debacle of Motor City Mayhem with Eli Drake, Johnny Impact, and El Patron.
That was a fuck up.
I don't think we should really get too much into that.
Mm.
You have the match with Two Scoots and Rosemary, and then the beginning was. Taiji Ishimori and Desmond Xavier for the X Division Championship. The rest of the show was build up to the Barbed Wire Massacre. The retirement of, well, when she gave up the Women's Championship, Allie becoming number one contender, of course, Laurel Van Ness being Knockouts Champion. Well, they did show EC3 and Aaron Rex when they inaugurated the Grand Championship. For the most part, the show was basically talking.
Yeah, you know what? If you have pee, if you're you might as well fast forward. It's fucking, you know, there's talking and then there's why the fuck. It's a wrestling show.
There's talking and then there's overkill.
Yeah, I mean, you'd expect that kind of shit from WWE. A snap.
Well, I don't even think WWE would go fucking as far as Impact did.
No. But it was nice to see Allie in Laurel Van Ness history.
Yeah.
From, you know, 2016 to now. I mean, it's going to be interesting to see them go at it, you know. And I think Allie is due to have the Knockouts Championship.
It's really good to see Allie's progression from the shy, naive, kind of ditzy, somewhat unfamiliar with the wrestling world kind of girl to actually being able to wrestle and cutting promos and having backstage stuff with another wrestler, and for freak's sake, I'm glad she's not talking in that really god-awful high voice anymore.
Yeah, like, I mean, when she came in, it was like, I didn't know she was in Smash. I didn't even know what Smash was until my brother introduced me.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, here's this woman who is now Maria Kanellis's chihuahua. And, yeah, it was just really fucking irritating. But then, so she goes on to have a storyline with Rex and Sutter. And that goes on to them having matches together against other people. And then it goes on to her becoming a wrestler. And now it's like, she is almost fucking there. And she's gonna be the new Knockouts champion.
Yeah, I mean, with Allie at the beginning, it sounded like she got a helium balloon stuck in her throat.
Yep, but now she's starting to act, you know, herself. Which is great.
It's actually kind of funny because when she would talk, her voice got high. When she got really mad and would yell, her voice would get higher. It's like, holy fuck, woman, how can you do that?
Yeah, I know.
I mean, shit. Her talking in the high voice is like Melina with her scream is like, does that not hurt your vocal cords doing that?
Oh, fuck.
Jesus.
But, you know, it was really cool for me to see Casey Spinelli versus Rosemary, because these two have had a great rivalry in Smash.
Yeah.
Rosemary comes to TNA, and, you know, a few years, you know, this last year even, I think it was, when I first saw Casey Spinelli in Border City Wrestling. And now she's on Impact, yeah. Which I think is fucking awesome. So, this match was cool, just to see that. You know, I try to compare their match to, like, fucking Smash. It's almost like Allie versus Rosemary.
In a way, yeah.
You know, it's like, let's see how that match compares to the match they had at Smash. It's pretty interesting to see that.
The interesting thing about this is, after the match, of course, Rosemary ended up winning, surprise. But after the match, Rosemary gets attacked by this completely random woman, and they're calling her Hayana?
Yeah.
And it's like, who the hell is this woman? Where the hell did she come from?
Yeah. Anaya. Well, anyways.
Anaya, I think, maybe. But then it's like, okay, we got a new girl on Impact. Cool.
Yeah.
Who is she? Where did she come from?
Well, she's gonna get her ass kicked by Rosemary next week, I'll tell you that much.
Probably.
Yeah.
But at least with, like, previous women that have gone to TNA Impact Wrestling, there was a history. You knew who they were, who they came from.
Yeah.
You know, the reasoning for going to Impact Wrestling, whatever. But there was some sort of background as to who they were, where they came from, championships they might have held, etc. Like Mickey James, Tara, Allie, Rosemary,
Angelina Love.
Yeah, Angelina Love, so on and so forth. But with this girl, it's like, don't know her from a hole in the wall, so to speak.
Yeah, but it'll be interesting to see what happens next week.
Yeah.
It was a pretty cool surprise to see somebody debut like that.
Just basically hop in the barricade, get in the ring, start kicking the crap out of Rosemary.
Some came the fuck out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was pretty cool to see the first Grand Slam Championship match.
Yeah.
You know, and like I said before, it's a shame that Aaron Rex went downhill from there.
Oh, I know.
And you know, Eddie Edwards, I'm not sure where he is at this time. But, you know, we'll find out.
Well, he competed last week.
Foul!
Eddie Edwards.
Oh, fuck.
Eddie Edwards and Moose against...
Yes.
Lashley and... KM. So,
he's
still around, but anyway.
Oh, my God. Where the hell am I? Oh, we saw him in Smash, too, actually.
Well, yeah.
But, regardless...
And you know, it was interesting because they talked about Eddie Edwards winning the Grand Honor Crown Heavyweight Championship. showed pictures of him with the title and winning the title and talked about it, and then all of a sudden he's gone for 3 weeks, I call it. Comes back, hey, no belt. So he obviously lost it to who? Don't know. But
yeah, I don't know.
I find that a lot, where somebody will win a championship from, more often than not, Japan.
Mm-hmm.
They'll hang on to it for a while. It'll be seen, talked about, whatever, and then when you see them again, they won't have it. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
They obviously lost the championship, but what happened?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Sure enough. The main event was awesome, like I said.
Yeah.
Got LX, you got Ohio versus everything. And there's a talk, obviously. And there's a best who competed in the first two. One was Saber, and then the other one was
Judas Messiah?
Yeah.
Messiah, whatever.
And, you know I got talked about last week, you know, Cactus Jack and yeah. Terry Funk. You know, and all their matches and that. And they're just. It's awesome, and this match was far more than expected.
Yeah.
You know, there's just barbed wire everywhere.
Barbed wire surrounding the ring, chairs wrapped in barbed wire boards. I think there might have been a baseball bat wrapped in barbed wire.
Yes.
A 2x4 wrapped in barbed wire, something like that.
Yeah, you know, and spikes. Oh my god.
Well, skewers.
Skewers.
What are skewers? Yeah, the end of the match was one of the Crest Brothers and Santana on a ladder. He's got a fistful of these wooden skewers, and it goes like this.
Yeah.
Onto his head, and he starts smacking them into his head, and then let's go, and they're just sticking in his head like a porcupine. And then suplex off the ladder through two tables, there's the end of your match.
Oh god, yeah.
But
a lot of them got all kinds of fucked up. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Like, okay, being wrapped around a barbed wire after he was caught.
Yeah. Get stuck in barbed wire. Cut one side, wrap you up in it, cut the other side, and then pick you up and give you a Death Valley driver through a barbed wire board.
Yeah.
Owie?
Yeah, that fucking hurt, but.
And then a suplex standing on two chairs through a barbed wire board, and this guy is going through barbed wire, and of course, because barbed wire isn't the strongest, as soon as you hit it, you put some weight on it, friggin' collapse, and it was Dave Chris or Jay? Goes into the barbed wire, and he kind of just, I guess, maybe not put all of his weight, but, you know, leaned up against it, and of course, it comes loose, he goes
right, you know, so kind of didn't really pick up on the start of the conversation.
Yeah, I'm not sure what happened there, man. I think it just quit before we realized it.
Yeah.
What we were starting to discuss, well, we were talking about the barbed wire massacre and having one of the Crest Brothers go into the barbed wire, it gives way, he goes flying over backwards onto the table and on the outside and just, yeah, gets wiped out. And then of course he got the other Crest Brother getting skewers shoved into his head, and he's looking like a porcupine.
That was fucking insane. Like, you don't see that in professional wrestling that much anymore.
And like, just when you think you've seen it all, something new comes up.
You know, well, especially Impact. And I think WWE needs to bring some of this stuff back. I know they weren't as hardcore as all of the other guys.
Right.
But they need to do something that's exciting.
Yeah.
There's a lot of cutbacks, and I know because I bitched about it.
Yes.
There's a lot of that. There just needs to be more excitement.
Yeah.
And NXT is a lot to. It's a better WWE show, if you will.
Taiji Ishimori and Desmond Xavier wrestled each other for the X Division Championship. The current champion right now is Ishimori. It was a very good match.
Yeah.
Well balanced, high flying, Japanese strong style, mat based wrestling. And you know, Matt was saying, the Japanese people get it, and they do. It's not how good you are at one style, or how many different people are good at different styles. It's how good are you at all the styles. Whether it be the Japanese strong style, whether it be the UK strong style, yeah. Whether it be chain wrestling, whether it be, you know, jumping off the top rope, whether it be physical, hardcore style, whether it be a catch-as-catch-can, whether it be what your overall well-roundedness is, as opposed to individuality.
Right.
But, yeah, the match itself was a good match, of course. Ishimori ended up retaining the title over Desmond Xavier.
Which is probably the best thing. I mean, you know, at least they have him as the champion. I'd like to see how far it goes. I mean, there's a lot of other wrestlers that he can go for. But at this point in time, let's see who else he could take on.
And you know, what I was talking about with Impact Wrestling being partners with Border City Wrestling, with the smaller, lesser known promotions out there, get another set of eyes on it, get more in the show and the company more exposure, and maybe get more interest in it, and then hopefully more people will watch it. Well, if you have a wrestler from another country and another promotion win a major title from the partnering promotion, well, that will give that title another audience,
yeah,
to see that particular brand of wrestling.
Yeah, like, you know, it's awesome because 10 years ago, you didn't know AAA.
No.
You didn't know NOAH. You didn't know New Japan or CMLL or any of that stuff unless you watched the Fight Network.
You wouldn't have necessarily known anything about the indies either.
No.
Unless you maybe read a magazine. Or somehow caught something of it on the internet.
Right. So
now that Impact has partnered with all these different promotions, whether it be NOAH, or AAA, or Border City, or whatever, it's a win-win situation for everybody.
Exactly. And that's the way it should be.
Yeah.
You know, variety. So,
and kind of a you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back kind of thing.
Yeah. Anyways. Let's go to Ring of Honor. Ring of Honor was pretty good. I mean, I don't know how many faces they have left. There seems to be way too many fucking heels.
Yeah.
I mean, you still got Jay Lethal, and that's great. But the Briscoes turned. You got Beer City Bruiser. So, let's talk about Beer City Bruiser. Actually, there was a match between Jay Lethal and this big guy. I can't remember his name.
Yeah.
And they had a match. And then Jay Lethal won. And then got blindsided by Beer City Bruiser. And then Silas Young come out. And then they're beating the shit out of him. And then this guy, I can't remember his name. Fuck it. So now, the three of them are a team.
Well, the week before, it was Beer City Bruiser asking Silas if he can go off, find a partner,
yeah,
and maybe at some point be Ring of Honor Tag Team Champion. Silas was like, well, you've proven yourself time and time again. You're really good in the ring. You've got good skills. You've impressed me. Go for it. And then this new guy and Bruiser are, I guess, partners.
Yeah, so it's going to be interesting to see what the future holds for the roster.
True.
I'm trying to figure, because there wasn't very many matches
in
Ring of Honor. You got Frankie Kazarian and Christopher Daniels come out. And of course, for weeks, they ran havoc. I think they recruited somebody.
Yeah, Scorpio Scott.
Right. So, and you know, it's pretty cool to see these two. I mean, Christopher Daniels has been a Ring of Honor wrestler before jumping to TNA. Then he met Frankie, they became buds, whatever, you know.
Mm.
So, Fallen Angel goes back to Ring of Honor. It's no longer Fallen Angel, but goes back to Ring of Honor. And he brings with him Frankie Kazarian. And so now they're a unit. They, you know, they go from heel to face. Now they're back heels.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they recruit Scorpio. And
they're calling them
Scorpio's guy.
SoCal. In fact, Southern California Extreme or something like that. And they're talking about, oh, we're still going to run roughshod over Ring of Honor, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that. And the COO of Ring of Honor comes out, and he's like, you know, these guys don't want to see me. They don't want to hear from you guys. They just want to see wrestling. And I was talking with our attorney, and he said that your contracts expire the end of this year. And so, by final battle this year, you're done. That's it. Cut off. They're all like, oh, fuck, we're screwed.
Yeah. So, it's kind of interesting how that's gonna go from here. Like, are they gonna leave right away? And, you know, is this gonna be their lead in the WWE?
Maybe.
Who knows? I mean, Christopher Daniels has been a wrestler now for
20 years?
20, 25 years.
Yeah.
That's 25 years exactly. And he's been all over. He's, like I said, Ring of Honor. TNA. So, it makes sense that let's see if they could try doing WWE. I mean, what could they lose? Have they been to WWE before? I don't know. I don't know. They might have done, at least I know, Daniels may have done dark matches, but who knows?
Possibly, yeah.
Possibly. So, who knows how this year is going to go for them.
You know,
which is kind of interesting, but you know, besides that, I really don't know what else happened. I think it was just, like, Impact, a bunch of talking.
Yeah, there really wasn't a whole lot else that went on. I mean, there was a hype-up for Punishment Martinez.
Yeah.
Ring of Honor World Champion.
So that'll be cool.
Other than that, I'm not sure exactly sure what else happened.
Yeah.
I think there's another match in there.
Oh, you know what? Yes, there was. There was Jay Lethal versus Will Ospreay. And then that's where the attack happened with Beer City Bruiser. And I'm all over the place because it was Will Ospreay versus Jay Lethal, so I might be thinking about Kenny King. Maybe it was Kenny King versus...
Yeah, it was Kenny King against this big dude.
Right, so... Yeah. Man, it was a good show. At least we remember what happened.
Yeah.
There's a lot of good websites out there, in case I forget.
Well, when... There's so much that happens, but the main thing you want to try and focus on kind of escapes your mind. It's like, okay, that was talking, there's this advertisement, oh yeah, there's this match, and then there's this match. Got it.
Right. But it was a good show, and you know what? Let's look forward to seeing what happens with the new staple that is Silas Young, Beer City Bruiser, and insert big fat guy.
Insert name here.
Yeah. And anyways, that was Ring of Honor. Chip! So then we're gonna go on now to NXT.
Yeah.
As much as it was cool last week, this week it was pretty much the same.
Another show from Atlanta, Georgia, and Center Stage.
But it did start off with
Heavy Machinery against Tino Sabatelli and Rodrick Moss.
And I was thinking about this too. It's pretty cool to see that we're going back to character-based wrestling. A lot of it was real-life people who, like back in the day, you got wrestlers who had occupations, and then it died out for the Attitude Era, but you still had kind of gimmicky wrestlers. So now, okay, what we have now with Sanity and these guys, Heavy Machinery, you know, I think his name is Otis?
Otis Dosevic and Tucker Knight.
Yeah. This was good. These two can have a really good feud.
Yeah.
Going for them. And I think that Heavy Machinery will eventually get another title shot. Just not right now, but they are a really good tag team. And so are these guys. Yeah, I was very impressed. And you know,
quite.
Once again, very impressed not only they paid homage to Bushwhackers. A guy that's twice my size do the worm.
Yeah.
That's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, a guy that's like, I don't know, 5'6" maybe?
Yeah.
200 and maybe 85 pounds. Short, stocky, compact. Going across the ring like he's a lightweight.
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, big things for Otis. I can't wait. But anyway, so that was a good match. You had William Regal be interviewed. Zelina Vega comes out, wants to talk to William Regal. And she's going on about how,
yeah, she basically wants Regal to call off the match between Andrade and Johnny. And basically, Regal's want nothing to do with it. And Vega finally goes, all right, if you want this.
She goes, well, why doesn't he go after the Velveteen Dream? Which doesn't make any sense. But you'll find out later in the night that Johnny Gargano accepts a match with Velveteen Dream, but there's still going to be the match between him and Andrade Cien Almas.
There you go.
I practiced all week. And so, we get to...
There was... Let's see. Lacey Evans.
Oh, yeah.
Against...
Aliyah.
Yes.
And Lacey Evans, I guess, is a heel now.
I guess,
which is,
yeah,
news to me.
She's, you know, they've been touting her as, you know, this strong military woman,
yeah,
member of the SWAT team and all that stuff, but also a mom and, you know, essentially a Southern Belle, so to speak,
yeah,
that can fight.
And she looks like she's from the 1940s, but...
Oh, yeah, she's got, like, the skirt and the top and
long hair.
But,
yeah.
Big brimmed hat. But it's the promo she got after the match wasn't very ladylike, so
to speak. Well, may I just say that poor Aliyah, I felt terrible for her.
Yeah.
But, yeah, sorry, go ahead.
You know, when I first saw her come out, and it's like, huh, haven't seen her in a while. But, and usually for her entrance, she had, like,
wire or whatever Kitty hears. Wednesday, she didn't have that. She was just kind of herself.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
It was, you know, a one-man ass kicking. And, oh my god, that punch. That knockout punch.
It's like... You think a woman can't punch? Yeah, watch that match. You'll find out real quick.
Wrong. Yeah, don't mess with a military woman. Shit.
Yeah. So, Lace is going on about, oh, this person's this. This person's that. It's about time a lady took over and that.
Shayna Baszler comes out and they go face to face.
Three sets of steps.
Yeah.
Going to the stage and as... Shayna's coming down one set, Lacey's going up the other, and then Shayna sees Allie kind of prone in the ring and gets in the ring and applies the rear naked choke, but they're calling it this other thing.
Yeah.
That draws out. You know, Ember Moon's like, oh, come on, get in the ring. And Shayna's like, oh, I forgot my gear. And it's like, well, you name the time, and I'll bring my title. And will you bring your gear and we'll have a match. And Shayna goes, all right, Philadelphia. So it seems as if Takeover Philadelphia is going to be an women's championship match between Shayna Baszler and Ember Moon.
Yeah. And it's going to be pretty cool because, you know, fucking Shayna Baszler is like Samoa Joe. Just fucking... There's no reason I'm gonna beat the shit out of this person. I'm gonna put them in a rear naked choke.
See, what they've got now is kind of what I was talking about, I think it was for our year end video. Shayna Baszler is still that ruthless, aggressive, I'm gonna kick your ass, I don't give a shit, and it's all about me doing my own thing, and no, I'm not here to make friends, yada yada yada, whatever. But when she was in the Mae Young Classic, it was that, but there was really kind of no reasoning for it. Okay, yeah, she wanted to win the Mae Young Classic, so did the other 31 women. But now it's like, okay, there's a focus, a goal behind why she's being so cruel, vicious, mean, aggressive, ruthless. She wants to be NXT Women's Champion, and it's not so much that Shayna has a character, so to speak. She's real, but you can't say it's a controlled realness?
Well, yeah, it's, well, she's bringing the MMA aspect to her persona.
Yeah.
The no-nonsense, don't fuck with me attitude.
Yeah.
And, you know what, it's great. It's great to see a female wrestler have that attitude. Because a lot of them do have it, but there's also a different side to them.
Yeah.
With Shayna Baszler, there is only, like, one level.
Yeah.
And that's, I'm gonna fuck you up, and you're gonna fucking take it.
Yeah. As much with Lacey Evans as it's like, okay, you get in my face, I'm gonna knock you out. With Shayna's like, you piss me off, I'll choke your ass the fuck out.
Oh, yeah. But, what was the main event we got?
Well, there was Rodrick Strong and Fabian Aichner.
Yes. And, you know, I just gotta say, when the hell did Rodrick Strong sound so feminine? I have no idea. He did not sound like that when he was in Ring of Honor. He must have got a tooth knocked out or something, but holy shit. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyways.
Well, the promo he cut was interesting because it was the week before Lars Sullivan had a match against Little Pissant Dude, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
He ends up winning.
Yep.
And then he calls out Killian Dane. Well, this week, Rodrick
kind of mimicking the wording of Lars calls out Lars.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, okay, so Lars wants Dane and Rodrick wants Sullivan. So you gotta kind of figure out, okay, you do Rodrick versus Lars, then Lars versus Killian, you do Lars versus Killian, Lars versus Rodrick, in two separate weeks.
Yeah.
You know, how do you sum this whole thing up, basically?
Yeah. But it was a good match, you know?
Yeah.
And I can't wait to see if they ever get Rodrick another match, and they will eventually.
Oh, yeah.
Another title match.
I'm sure they will.
You know, but once again, it's going to be awesome to see the Extreme Rules match, Adam Cole versus Aleister Black, and, you know, we'll look forward to that when we do our review. It's going to be amazing. I can't wait.
That'll come up next week.
Yeah. So let's head over now to SmackDown.
All right.
Mm-hmm. I missed the beginning, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So I don't know what happened.
Well, there was the semifinals for the United States Championship.
Yeah.
It was Roode against Mojo, Jinder Mahal against Xavier, which I had said last week, but I didn't think so, but it actually was. So, my mistake. Anyways, so Jinder ended up beating Xavier. Roode ended up beating Mojo. And they were going to have the United States Championship Finals for next week's SmackDown. It was originally touted to be for the Royal Rumble, but I guess somehow plans changed and they moved it to next week. But Roode wanted to face Jinder that night, so it was talked about, it was okayed. So the finals of the United States Championship were this week, and the glorious one.
Glorious! New United States Champion.
Yes.
And yes, it's a United States Champion, not another Canadian, but
who cares?
Who cares? He's a champion.
Yeah.
And WWE. That's one step closer to the WWE Championship.
Yes.
So this is great. I don't know what they're going to do now for Royal Rumble, but this is great. I mean, the fact that they did this now, I mean, a lot of people said, okay, had Bobby Roode feud with Dolph Ziggler, why not give the title to Bobby Roode? But it has happened anyways, and I'd like to see how far they go with it, and I think it's great.
Yeah.
I'm glad they're giving Bobby Roode a push, and could be prouder, I guess.
Mm.
As a Canadian and someone who lives in Peterborough, Ontario, I'm very happy.
Yeah. To see a guy that kind of grew up here, got into wrestling school, got into wrestling, made it very well on TNA for a lot of years.
Yeah.
And was multiple championships there, came to WWE, and was the NXT champion there, and then made his way to the main roster, and then to have main championship in the main roster is pretty cool.
Yeah, and, you know, just great. It's awesome, and I can't wait to see where they go with this.
Yeah.
But, anyways, what else happened? That's actually when I came in, when they had that match.
Yeah. Let's see.
Oh, there was another Fashion Files, I think. Or did they not do that this week?
I've been noticing lately, they've been doing these faster files on WWE.com. But I think this week was Tyler Breeze trying to impersonate Renee Young again.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
And doing an interview with Bludgeon Brothers, I think.
And then of course you got the Ascension. You know, what happened to you guys? Come on.
You started off as probably one of the baddest tag teams to come out of NXT. And now you're just a comedy act.
That doesn't make sense. Come on. Like, yeah. It kicks some ass. It's crazy, but,
quit being pushed over, you start pushing people over.
You know, it's kind of like, yeah, but... SmackDown, interesting show this week, and you got to finally see, well, for the time being, Shane McMahon and Daniel Bryan hold up Bobby Roode's hand, presenting him with...
And that. Actually, B... Commissioner and general manager, and not be too
childish
4-year-olds arguing with each other.
Yeah. So that was nice to see. But yeah, like I said, Bobby Roode, the new United States champion. Congratulations.
Yeah.
So let's head to Raw.
Oh, was this ever fun?
Yeah.
He got Braun Strowman to start off the night. He comes out and he's talking about how he's gonna beat up Kane and he's gonna beat up Brock Lesnar and he's gonna be the new Universal Champion and all this other stuff. And Kurt comes out and he's like, well, you're lucky that Brock and Kane are still able to compete, but you're not. You're fired. And then friggin' Braun Strowman raising hell all over the place.
Yeah.
Putting Heath Slater through a table and catering and just going out to the production truck and intimidating people and, you know, throwing around security and then finally to dislodge the cab of the production truck and flip it over. And then to go out and intimidate the announcers and want to beat up Michael Cole and then...
Oh God, yeah.
Have Kurt Angle come out and be like, alright, you're rehired. Stephanie rehired you. It's still going to be a triple threat match for the Universal title. Please don't hurt Michael Cole. And then, whee! Michael Cole, go bye-bye.
Yeah. There we have ourselves a flying Cole. That was insane. Well, it didn't look bad, but...
Well, he had security to land on, looking for his fat ass.
Exactly.
Otherwise, who knows
what... Fat asses.
Yeah.
But, yeah... Well, I think there was a part on Raw where the Revival came back, and they were facing... I don't know what those jobbers' names were.
Well, the Revival came back last week, and they were facing different, or a new tag team or something like that.
It's really cool to see, it's refreshing to see a new tag team that takes the old school element of, well, their catchphrase, fists, not flips, and their tag team, like when we were kids.
Yeah.
So after this match, they had an interview with Charlie Caruso, and they were talking about how they're not flashy, they're also not sports entertainers, they're professional wrestlers, which, I don't know why, but that really made me feel, I thought it was pretty cool to hear that, because I've been watching the show for years, and it was all about sports entertainment and WWE. I haven't heard that professional wrestler in a while, and I think it's awesome. I think that's what this company was based on, and that's what it needs to be, professional wrestling. And hopefully the Revival will one day capture the Raw Tag Team Champions.
I really think the biggest thing is years ago it was you'd go to Madison Square Garden, you go to the Boston Garden, you go to the Maple Leaf Garden, you go to the Philadelphia Spectrum, you go to Dallas Sportatorium, go to other places, and you'd watch wrestling. Now, it's still wrestling, but it's also like Make-A-Wish Foundation, Susan G. Komen, and Connor's Cure, and various other things that are outside of what you see on TV, which kind of is what's made it sports entertainment, so to speak. Like, it is wrestling still, but it's not the main focus like it was years ago.
Right.
I mean, you still got companies that straight up solely concern themselves with just wrestling, like a AAA, like a Pro Wrestling NOAH, like a Lucha Underground, like a New Japan Pro Wrestling, like a Border City Wrestling, like
CMLL.
Yeah, and so on and so forth. The biggest thing with WWE is the outside realm of in-ring competition. And now you've got, you know, Total Divas, you've got Total Bellas, you've got 365, 24, you know, things that really give you an in-depth look at the lives of these people outside of the ring. And you never really saw that.
No, not really. I mean, there was a time where, I'm not sure if it was WrestleMania, back in, like, WrestleMania 5.
Mm.
It was almost like it was a charity. And at the same time, yeah, they weren't out of character, but they kind of were.
Yeah.
They were associating with kids and having a good time.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, I mean, it was also all baby faces. Like now, it's baby faces and heels who break character. They hang out with children with disabilities or life-threatening illnesses.
Oh yeah, like that'll take the time and, you know, like I said before, the Make-A-Wish Foundation.
Yeah.
They've been working with the Make-A-Wish Foundation for ever, like since the 80s, I think.
Yeah.
And the who's who of the wrestlers have worked with the Make-A-Wish Foundation. And to have somebody that has a mental illness or a disability or, you know, whatever, can say, hey, I want to meet John Cena. Hey, I want to meet Randy Orton. Hey, I want to meet Roman Reigns. Hey, I want to meet Dolph Ziggler. Hey, I want to meet Big Show. Hey, I want to meet Sheamus. Hey, I want to meet Kurt Angle, Daniel Bryan, so on and so forth. But there's also the aspect of, okay, you're talking about wrestlers being out of character and, you know, spending time with children and that, and WrestleMania specifically. One of the biggest things is WrestleMania early on was a sole entity. It was the one night of the year. We have a big stadium, thousands upon thousands of people, a huge card, and you just go out and you wrestle and have, you know, a good time, whatever. Well, they also do the Hall of Fame, but that it was its own separate thing as well.
Yes.
Then, as the years progressed, they made it a whole huge thing. You have
Well, okay, let's take WrestleMania last year, for example. You have Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony, TakeOver Orlando, and then WrestleMania. You know, Royal Rumble weekend, it's going to be TakeOver Philadelphia and the Royal Rumble.
Fan access?
Well, that's kind of what I was getting at. They have the weekend being big, the Hall of Fame, the TakeOver event of whatever city WrestleMania is going to be in, and then WrestleMania itself. But before the weekend, the week itself, you got fan access. You got, there's a golf tournament, I think they have. And all this media and press and radio shows and talk shows and reading week and WrestleMania has grown so much that instead of it just being one night, it's like a whole week thing from the Monday of that week to WrestleMania on that Sunday. It's jam-packed. Not only with Monday Night Raw, SmackDown, NXT, and then, like I said, you got the fan access, meet and greet, and, you know, go around to look at all the cool stuff, get autographs, and take pictures, and all this other stuff. And there's this golf tournament, and then you got the Hall of Fame, the TakeOver event, and then WrestleMania itself. It just goes to show you, in my opinion, not only has WrestleMania grown in the aspect of, in the beginning, it was just, you'd go to movie theater maybe, or a library, or school gymnasium, or an auditorium somewhere, and you could watch WrestleMania on closed circuit television. Oh. Now you got pay-per-view, you got the WWE Network, and it's just immense at how far the WrestleMania event itself has come over the years, but as well as the lead up to WrestleMania has gotten bigger. It's like I said, WrestleMania was just basically a one night thing, one and done, that's it.
Yeah.
Now, it's a whole week, maybe 2 week long thing. We're also talking about wrestlers breaking character and meeting people. It was, oh boy, let's see here now. 15 years ago, I was in Toronto at Woodbine, which is a racetrack in Toronto, and I got to meet wrestlers. I got to meet Kurt Angle, I got to meet Sable, I got to meet Troy Wilson, I got to meet Rey Mysterio, Chris Benoit, Matt Hardy. It was gonna be Charlie Haas and Shelton Benjamin, but I think it was only Charlie Haas. Shelton Benjamin ended up with delayed flight or whatever. He wasn't able to make it to the thing anyways, but yeah. It just goes to show you what WWE has done to not only be interactive with fans, you know, that go to the shows, but to go outside of that and meet people that watch them on TV.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, that's good. And I think, you know, I hope it continues for years. And when he told me that, though, I was pretty jealous.
Yeah.
But there it is. All I got Matt Hardy, DB, is, well, a smoking Matt.
Another Matt. Yes, you were able to see Matt Hardy in a match this week.
Yeah, not too happy with his theme music, but it is what it is. I don't want, like, a carbon copy of the Impact broken mat, but it's, it, you know.
It's not entirely the same. Yes, no. It's a piano, but they mixed it in with whatever's with it.
Yeah.
I mean, this is not the worst thing in the world, but it's not the greatest either.
No, I could have had better, but I mean, it is what it is. It was an interesting match.
It seems to be they're really pushing Matt Hardy and Bray Wyatt.
Yes.
And I think the reasoning for that is they're really kind of pushing Bray Wyatt and Finn Balor, but that got cut short because of, you know, all the shit that went down. So now that Matt Hardy has converged into this woken side, and it's like, okay, you've got, who can out crazy who?
Yeah, and you know, the laughing is too much. But yeah, it's like, kind of the deranged leader versus the deranged, whatever you want to call him, Matt Hardy.
Yeah.
You know, but they should have a match at Royal Rumble. I'm surprised that's not on the bill. But
yeah,
Royal Rumble looks stacked enough as it is.
Oh yeah.
So, again, looking forward to that. You know, it's just one of those things where I have to see where this goes with Matt. Got another thing with Jason Jordan.
Yeah.
Well, it was good. I can't think of what else happened. I'm trying to...
Well, there was Seth Rollins against Finn Balor.
Yes. That was cool.
Yeah.
And debut of the re-sign, whatever you want to call it, curb stomp.
Yeah, introduced.
Yeah.
Re-legalized, maybe? I don't know.
And the thing is, okay, it was banned because it was dangerous. It's professional wrestling, dickheads. Mm. It's supposed to be dangerous. It's not ballet.
Yeah.
Yeah, they tried to do that shit with the broke kick. Mm. It didn't work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm glad that it's back. You know, a lot of people talk smack about Finn Balor. And I kind of enjoy his work.
Yeah, a lot of people seem to think that Finn Balor is garbage, he's no good, he sucks, he's not a very good wrestler. I disagree. Mm-hmm. He's a very talented wrestler. He can hold his own. He's held his own against guys like John Cena,
yes,
Randy Orton, you know, Seth Rollins, and whoever else he's been against. He's not Roman Reigns. He's done very well for himself.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the thing, too. It's just, you know, I can understand. It's like there's an alter ego, but that only comes out every once in a while.
Yeah.
And now it's just Finn Balor.
And if you only like Finn Balor because he has this demon side, get over yourself.
Yeah, there's a lot more to him than you ever know. And watch his matches in Japan. They're fucking awesome. Mm-hmm. But, so anyways, you get Nia Jax versus Asuka.
Which was, it pretty much was a one-sided ass kicking.
Let me put it to you this way. Their match in NXT, far more better.
You could say that, yeah.
But, yeah, Nia Jax gets injured.
Yeah.
And then, I guess it was real. And then Alexa Bliss coming out, which, kind of interesting, seeing as how they're friends in real life, but at the same time, it's, well, it should be competition, but anyways, yeah, she gets carried out, and then they're 10 to the back. Of course, who should show up but Gonzo himself and Zomori.
How you doing?
And then him and Alexa Bliss have a blonde off.
Yeah, exactly. Alexa's like, go away, I got this, I'm her best friend. And Angela's like, well, With all due respect, sweetheart, I got this, you know, and I kind of got a thing going, and I was like, yeah, Alexa, get out of here.
Yeah.
Because it seems like it's been teased a lot that Enzo and Naya are going to kind of be an item, but there's been things get in the way of that.
Yeah.
So, hopefully, maybe some point they'll finally, you know. But, you never know.
And I'm not quite sure how I finished, but I know how I left because there's too many goddamn commercials.
The match went on with Seth Rollins and Finn Balor. It was a good match. It was pretty much as good as it was when they wrestled for the Universal title at SummerSlam. Back and forth, strong shots. Stiff shots. You have Balor roll up Seth Rollins, and it seemed like there was a three count, but referee said there was only two. There was a kick kick. And then so the match goes on. Balor goes against the ropes. Jordan trips him. He stumbles. He goes down. Curb stomp. Match over. And they show the replay of the pinfall, and you could clearly see the referee's hand. One, two, three. Now, whether it was kind of a putting his hand down to reposition himself and then count, I don't know, but it seems as if there might be a little bit of controversy to possibly Finn beat Rollins before Rollins beat Finn. They might say something about that next week. I don't know, but
that'll be interesting. I don't know how that would work. But anyways, I left, so I guess it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So, it was a good Raw, despite a few things, I guess. I can't think of what else happened, so let's go on now to 205.
That was a short show, holy fuck.
Yeah, I don't understand. I mean,
they went from SmackDown to the Mixed Match Challenge, and then when the Mixed Match Challenge ended, they went straight to 205.
Yeah.
So it was like, okay, SmackDown ends at 10 o'clock, go to the Mixed Match Challenge. It's 10 to 10:30. Mixed Match Challenge ends. Go to 205 Live. It's 10:30 to 11. Let's call it, or 10:30 to maybe 10 to 11, whatever. It ends, and it's like, holy hell.
For the next little while until this Mixed Match Challenge thing ends, it's going to be like, boom, boom, boom.
Yeah. Well, and you know, you get Goldust taking on
Drew Gulak and Arya Davari and Tony Nese.
Yeah, you know, and this is a thing. I can understand why you get Goldust helping out Cedric Alexander, but this match didn't make a lot of sense. It's called 205 for a reason. Dustin is fucking 6 feet, maybe less.
6'6".
6'6". Why would you have him in a match in 205? It doesn't make any sense, but
and kind of the lead up to it is Enzo and Goldust kind of going back and forth, and Enzo goes, dude, you're not even short on 5 pounds, and Goldust goes, yeah, I know.
But, yeah, it was an interesting match. Like, I don't know what to say. Why does 205 exist? I don't get it. Just have some people on SmackDown and some people on Raw, because if you're gonna start pulling this bullshit, then. But meanwhile, you have Jack Gallagher. He was talking about Hideo Itami and how Hideo Itami took Brian Kendrick out of action, so he wants to have a match with him.
Get his revenge.
It's gonna be awesome, man. Headbutt versus the kick. You know, I think that, again, Japanese strong style versus UK powerhouse. It's just like very cool just to see that. And Gallagher is very good as a heel.
Yeah.
It's not like I had my reservations, but once again, it's WWE and they need more faces, but it is what it is. So I am looking forward to this match. It could happen at the Royal Rumble, who knows? Just wait and see. It's gonna be fun. I can't wait when that happens. But yeah, 205 was short, which is great.
Yeah. Meh.
So then we go on to Smash.
Boy, and that was certainly a interesting show.
And you want to talk about raps, like last week. We go to Kevin Bennett and his crew doing a rap outside of, it looked like a, outside of a store or restaurant or somewhere on a highway.
Yeah, and they're doing a rap. Where the fuck that was.
And it's like, I never really watched a TV show where you got to cuss and not have it be like.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know if it's a Canadian thing. I don't fucking know, but it's a lot of, like, fuck and shit and all this other stuff. Okay. And so that was an interesting rap.
There was Matt Sydal.
Yeah.
And Matt Cross.
Yes.
Against, what did they call themselves? Sydal and Cross? With some really weird name.
Yeah.
Whatever it was.
Some of them.
And then Sydal and Cross ended up winning the match using a double shooting star press.
Right.
And I will say, Sydal's shooting star press is a little more refined, kind of technically sound than Matt Cross. And like, don't get me wrong, his was good, but as far as like looking at it and going, oh, that was awesome, he kind of leaned more towards Sydal than he did Cross.
Yeah, that is true. And plus, he's also the veteran.
Yeah.
A guy that has gone through WWE, Ring of Honor, TNA Impact, you know, just all over, like even Japan. I'm sure. It's just this guy is a natural in the ring, and it's awesome. I can't wait to see what else they do with him.
And yeah.
If he stays in Smash, I don't know, but it'd be interesting to see, because right now, he's still in Impact, as far as I'm concerned. So if he jumps back and forth. Once again, this is pre-recorded too, so this could have happened months ago.
Yeah, man, I mean, he could have did however many matches with Smash and then eventually made his way to Impact.
Yeah, so that was a good match. And then get the highlight of last week with Kevin Blackwood and Scotty O Shay and the whole I know your secret, and
I know it, you know it, they don't, and the baptism by blood thing, yeah, and then
the keyboard, and
they show, and next week it's going to be Blackwood and O'Shea against another team, I don't remember who the hell it was, and a tag match, and it's like, okay, this is going to be interesting.
But yeah, so then there was the main event. We got Tyson Dux, the Smash champion, who took on
One Man Dynasty. Yeah. Money Man, yeah. Brent Banks.
And holy shit, what a match.
Oh yeah, man.
Oh, that is fucking professional wrestling. There was a lot of close calls, great hits. Tyson Dux got busted open.
Yeah.
And then he wins by this fucking crazy Boston Crab like move.
Yeah, he earlier put Brent Banks in as the Boston Crab. But Brent Banks was able to crawl over and grab the rope.
Yeah.
The end of the match, he puts her in the Boston Crab. It looks like Brent Banks is going to get to the ropes. He turns him over, pulls him to the center ring, reaches down, grabs both arms by the hand and the wrist, and turns back over into Boston Crab while holding on to his hands and is like, yeah, he's not going anywhere. He's not getting out of this. The only way out of it is, okay, I give.
So, he retained the title. He's talking about his respect for Brent Banks.
Brent Banks being one of the pillars of Smash Wrestling. And then he's talking about, like, Sebastian Swalve and, you know, these other guys who are, like, the main stable of Smash Wrestling. And then he got Evil Uno come out. And kind of Uno and Tyson are having a stare down. And then here comes Stu Grayson. And Stu Grayson gives Tyson Dux this backbreaker, chin checker type move. And then you got the Super Smash Brothers beating up on Tyson Dux. And then here comes Frankie the Mobster.
Oh, yeah.
The Beast King. Frankie TM.
PTM.
To make the save, and Tyson Dux goes back on the microphone and he's like, man, you didn't have to jump me from behind. If you wanted a title match, all you had to do was ask. And it's like, alright, you decide which one of you two wants me for the title. And then Frankie grabs the mic and goes, I want that guy. I'll take the other one.
Yeah.
So it looks like it's going to be Evil Uno and Tyson Dux for the title. And then another time would it be Frankie and Stu Grayson.
Right. So that's going to be awesome.
Yeah, that'll be good.
And of course, you know, I thought about this too. You know, WWE Monday Night Raw for years was always taped in the Manhattan Center in New York. But now it's like you get Smash Wrestling, which is, it's mostly being taped right now at the Opera House in Toronto.
Yeah, they've done the Opera House.
They've done the Opera House. They've done Fanshawe in London.
Yeah.
They've done Montreal. So, right now, it's mostly being based at the Opera House.
Mm.
But it's a great show, and I suggest everybody go watch it. You know, if it's in your country, you gotta watch it. It's awesome. We've both been to a show. I was at a show. And it's great. So, it's this week in wrestling is awesome. A lot of good moments. A lot of moments that we could have done without. But I can't wait to see what happens next week.
I'd say this week there was a lot more highs than there were lows.
That is true. That is true. But I can't wait. Next week is the Raw 25th anniversary. Got a lot of great people, got a lot of great wrestlers coming back from the past.
Oh yeah, man.
It's gonna be fucking awesome. Mm. I can't wait for that. I can't wait to see what happens with the tag team, with Evil Uno and Duke Grayson, with Tyson Dux and Frankie TM. And it's gonna be great. You know, you got Spinelli and Rosemary. You got what's gonna be in the aftermath with fucking Ohio versus everything and LAX. Mm-hmm. You know, what's going to be Bobby Roode's next mission? What's going to be Braun Strowman's next mission?
Mm.
It's going to be awesome week next week. And then, of course, we're going to hit the Royal Rumble. So, you know, it's going to be jam-packed. I am looking forward to it.
Certainly, sir.
So, this has been a great week in wrestling. For Killer Kyle, I mean Matt, and we will see you next time.
Peace.
Yeah.